What is, I think, a special feature is that we developed systems so that we can conduct shRNA screens directly in the mice in vivo, and I will show you some examples for that. We are doing this to, first of all, dissect tumor suppressor networks in liver cancer and also more recently in other tumor types. We can conduct so-called lethal screens, synthetic lethality screens, to directly pinpoint new drug targets in cancer. But we are also interested to develop new therapeutics to increase endogenous regeneration of damaged livers. And last but not least, a major focus of the lab is to study cellular senescence and how senescence counteracts tumor development in the liver. So we'll first, as I mentioned already, talk about cellular senescence, some published data as an overview, and then some new data on this topic. And then later on, I will give an example how we can conduct direct in vivo RNAi screens to find new therapeutic targets in liver cancer. Let's start with senescence. As all of you know, senescence is a stable cell cycle arrest and is a fail-safe mechanism that counteracts tumor development. And senescence can actually occur in different conditions. First of all, replicative senescence as a consequence of telomere shortening, as all of you know. Then we have senescence induction by the induction of oncogenes, point mutations in oncogenic RAS. For example, we have drug-induced senescence and some other forms, radiation-induced senescence. And most important, senescence has been denounced as a cell culture artifact for quite a long time, but thanks to a series of very elegant studies that were, some of them were published back-to-back in Nature in 2005 and 2006, we now know that actually senescence is indeed a very important fail-safe mechanism against tumorigenesis. You all know that senescent cells show a very typical morphology. They show this fried egg morphology. They show particular changes in their chromatin structure. And you all know about these features. They have been described extensively. Over the past couple of years, it also has become clear that senescent cells secrete with their environment. Senescent cells secrete various factors that actually play different roles. And we now know that this so-called senescence-associated secretory phenotype is a complicated thing and is actually a double-edged sword regarding tumorigenesis. Initially, this is around 10 years ago, it was shown that this secreted factors from senescent cells can actually promote tumorigenesis. This was an experiment done by Judith Campisi's lab, where they co-incubated senescent fibroblasts with breast cancer cells. They incubated these subcutaneously on nude mice, and they could see that the breast cancer cells grew more rapidly in the presence of the senescent fibroblast. However, the situation became more complicated because it was shown, for example, by Jesus Gill's group and Daniel Pieper's group, that these secreted factors from senescent cells are also very important to actually induce and to reinforce the senescence program. And to reinforce a cell cycle arrest, a stable cell cycle arrest, is of course, or must be seen as a tumor suppressive mechanism. Last but not least, towards the end of my postdoc, we found that if we drive aggressive liver carcinomas into senescence, that this evokes actually an immune response against these senescent tumor cells and leads to tumor cell clearance. This, of course, also being an anti-tumorigenic effect in contrast to the other side. So just to briefly touch on that study, because this is what was our initial stimulus to get more involved also in the more recent data, which I will show you. This study actually started very simple. We had no intention to study senescence. We simply wanted to ask the question whether aggressive liver carcinomas need sustained P53 inactivation for growth. And what the consequence is of reactivating endogenous P53. And to address this question, we used one of our older mouse models. This is a chimeric mouse model where we can induce liver carcinomas by isolating bipotential liver progenitor cells, take these cells into culture, and here we transduce these cells using retroviruses with a TET-responsive shRNA against P53, and we co-transduce with oncogenic RAS and the TET transactivator. And this way, we can grow autotopic liver carcinomas where then using doxycycline, we can actually switch off the shRNA against P53, and this way we can reactivate endogenous P53 levels. And what we found was very striking, that these tumors actually quickly went into remissions, and these were long-lasting remissions. However, it was at the beginning was a paradox, because we could not find apoptosis in these tumors, and took us quite a while to figure out what was going on. And this is really a shortcut now that summarizes the result of this old study. And this is that the reactivation of P53 in these liver carcinomas leads to senescence induction, which then comes along with the secretion of a lot of cytokines and chemokines. And this triggers actually an immune response, in this case, purely an innate immune response. NK cells, neutrophils, and macrophages are involved, and these cells actually clear these senescent tumor cells. So this was the first demonstration that senescent cells actually interact with the immune system. And now more recently, we tried to follow up on that path and address the question whether this interaction between the senescence program and the immune system is also relevant for early tumor suppression, for tumor surveillance. So in other words, is immune surveillance of precancerous senescent cells relevant for tumor suppression in the liver? And a couple of these slides that I will show you have been published last year. So we used, in this case, a slightly different chimeric mosaic mouse model. In this model, we are using transposon vectors that are delivered into the mouse liver using a special delivery technique, so-called hydrodynamic tailwind injection. And we use a transposon vector that can carry an oncogene or an shRNA, and we co-deliver this with a second plasmid that encodes transposase. And doing this, we can then accomplish stable integration of the transposon into hepatocytes in vivo. And this approach is very efficient. You can see here that we can detect NRAS expressing cells, hepatocytes expressing oncogenic NRAS. And this induction of oncogenic NRAS comes along with an activation of the RAS-MAP kinase pathway. And these cells actually, they stain senescent. And as I will show you later, all cells here, all hepatocytes that have overexpression of NRAS stain senescence. So we don't have primary escapers in this system. I will show you data on that later. And we have some additional markers like SA-beta-gal, which we can do on sections or on whole mounts, and P16 and some more. Very important control was, I will come to that later, was the effector loop mutant, which is the same RAS construct with one additional point mutation, and this point mutation renders a mutant that cannot signal downstream. So you see that we can detect the RAS expression, however, there is no activation, we can't detect phosphoERK, and of course there's no senescence induction. Now we first had a look at these livers to see what's going on, and it was very striking to see that, first of all, many hepatocytes change morphology, these cells look different. You could say they have this senescence typical morphology, and they stain positive for the markers that I just introduced to you. And most prominent was that these cells were surrounded by a ring of immune cells. And of course, at this point, it was already a theory that also, in this case, these precancerous hepatocytes are subject to some kind of immune attack. And if you have attraction of immune cells, you should expect to have chemoattractants mediating this process, and so we analyzed whole liver lysates and also purified senescent hepatocytes and found some known but also some unknown factors secreted from these senescent hepatocytes. And some of these I will mention later. For example, here the MCP1, I will come back to that later. We also, and I can go through this quickly, we also did flow cytometry analysis on these senescent mouse livers, and we found a strong influx. We are comparing here the effector loop mutant, the cells are expressing NRAS, but it's not signaling, there's no senescence. We're comparing this to those livers that actually have senescent hepatocytes, and we see a strong influx of neutrophils and NK cells, for example here more than 17-fold. But also as the linker between innate and adaptive immunity, dendritic cells, and more subtle but always significant, also an influx of CD4 and CD8 T lymphocytes. And we see this not only in the liver but also in the portal lymph nodes. So of course at this point it was the theory that probably these immune cells are taking care of these precancerous senescent hepatocytes, and to really look into this we did time course analysis, and this is shown here, and you can see that already here at day 30, 1 month after induction of cellular senescence, the amount of senescent hepatocytes, NRAS positive hepatocytes, is down to around 2%, and at day 60 we can't find any senescent hepatocytes anymore. In contrast, and this is now very important for all later assays that I will show you, if we look at the effector loop mutant, we can see that there is a slight decrease here, a few percent, but there is a large proportion of these NRAS expressing hepatocytes that we can detect long-term meaning really many months as we followed this up. And this is of course important, because you could say that we may have a problem because there's an immune response against the overexpressed peptide per se, but that's not the case, because here we can detect these NRAS expressing cells